Hey guys, I'm here at the Chocolate Museum in Cusco, Peru. Let's get technical. I'm here to find out why chocolate is shiny. I guess I could have Googled it, but yeah.
Have you ever noticed that? It's crazy. It's one of those things you don't really notice or care about until you do. I mean, chocolate doesn't start off shiny, right? It starts off with beans. Or does it? Wait, hold up. No, this isn't Vsauce. Turn that off. Well, these can vary on the type of chocolate you're making. There are three main ingredients in chocolate. Cacao paste, which is half cacao butter and half cacao powder, sugar, and cacao nibs. Wait a sec. I recognize nibs from somewhere.
New case, new nib. Red 20 words? That's a nib. That nib was kind of small.
Hey, Sarge, you may want to slow down on those things.
Things? These are the precious jewels of the rainforest, boy.
By the way, quick side note, for those of you who don't watch Brooklyn Nine-Nine, you totally should. And for those of you who do watch Brooklyn Nine-Nine, oh my god, I can't wait for season 5. Season 4 ended on, like, such a cliffhanger. In the season 3 Brooklyn Nine-Nine episode, The Oolong Slayer, Boyle introduces Terry to cacao nibs, calling them happy little chocolatey delights from deep in the Peruvian rainforest. In reality, wouldn't really recommend cacao nibs. They're pretty bitter, don't really taste anything like chocolate, but they are crucial in the chocolate-making process. How? Well, let me answer that by asking you this. What role does a cacao bean play in the chocolate-making process?
Don't they just grind it up or something?
Nope. Beans like that one have to be fermented, dried, and roasted before they can be put into a machine called a winnower. Winnowing is the process of removing the shell of the cocoa bean with what's inside, the nib. See, when you roast cocoa beans, the outer shell and the inner nib are loosened. Then it's easy for the winnower to rake, suck, and remove the two different parts. The nibs are then grinded to turn into chocolate liqueur, and then pressed to turn into chocolate powder, which, along with being used in the chocolate-making process, can also be used to make hot chocolate and beauty products. Hey, that's pretty good.
Hey, that's pretty good.
Actually, that's pretty good. The cacao powder is then combined with cacao butter to create cacao paste. The butter and the powder are held together with something called beta crystals. Remember this, it gets important later. So, this cacao paste, sugar, and cacao nibs are the ingredients that go into chocolate, but it still isn't shiny yet. After mixing, refining, and conching, we finally get to the part of the process that turns chocolate shiny. Tempering.
But what is tempering?
Oh, no, I don't know, but like usual, while I may not know something, I know someone who does. This guy is one of the amazing people who works over at Choco Museo in Cusco, and I asked him, why is chocolate shiny?
Shiny because the composition of cacao is 50% cacao butter and 50% cacao powder. So cacao has beta crystals, yeah? These crystals maintain the butter and the powder together in the cacao paste. If you want to activate these crystals, the beta crystals, it's really important to make the tempering step. In the tempering step, we're going to activate the beta crystals.
Okay, wait a sec. Let's break that down before we move on. Chocolate is a polymorph. Poly meaning many, and morph meaning structure. Many structures. The official definition, a polymorph is a solid that can exist in multiple crystal structures. A crystal is a group of atoms or molecules that has a specific organization to them, and a crystal structure is exactly what it sounds like, the structure of the crystals. Since chocolate is a polymorph, its crystals can exist in different structures, 6 different structures to be exact. This ability is largely due to the cocoa butter, or more specifically, what's found inside of it, oleic, palmitic, and stearic fatty acids. Those are hard words. Remember, only the crystal structure changes. Chocolate is still chocolate, and the molecules or any of the actual chemical makeup doesn't just swap in and out. Not that in and out, just like, you know, like switching or something. I wonder how many people are actually gonna get that joke. I mean, yeah, because it only lands if they know what In-N-Out Burger is. By the way, there's no one over there. I'm just alone in my room, so... that's weird. Anywho, this is where tempering comes in. When chocolate cools at room temperature, it solidifies into crystals that are all different shapes and sizes. Tempering is where you control the firmness, taste, quality, and what we're interested in, shininess of chocolate by getting your desired chocolate crystal structure using a very controlled temperature. Please subscribe. The perfect crystal structure for chocolate is the fifth, or as he says in the interview, the beta crystal. Those two ways of saying it, by the way, are interchangeable. The fifth structure can be obtained by cooling the chocolate very slowly. This maximizes the amount of form 5 chocolate and minimizes all the other forms. Then, after you cool it down, you heat it right back up to just below the melting point of form 5, which is 33.8 degrees Celsius. This melts all the other forms of chocolate besides form 5 because they have lower melting points. So, in summary, to activate the beta crystals, aka the fifth form of chocolate, which is found in the cacao butter holding it and the cacao powder together, you must temper the chocolate perfectly. And it's these beta crystals that make chocolate shiny. Along with making chocolate shiny, we also have the beta crystals to thank for the melt-in-the-mouth feel and that glorious, glorious snap.
Man, is that satisfying.
Pro weight loss tip, don't eat your chocolate, just break it in half. Just as awesome, zero calories. Now that we know all that, let's head back to the interview.
After the Melanger, can you see this machine over there? After the Melanger machine, after 24 hours, the chocolate is going to be really warm, between 45 and 50 degrees. To activate the beta crystals, we have to use the marble stone to make the tempering step. On the marble stone, the chocolate should be between 25 and 28 degrees, coldest. Then you can make bars, bonbons, whatever you want.
Cool. Very cool. But wait a sec. What if we get something wrong? What if we don't temper the chocolate perfectly? I know someone. Hey, Anais?
Hey, Alex. What's up?
What happens if we get another crystal structure of chocolate? Say, 1 through 4, or 6 even?
Ah, good question. If you temper at a different temperature, it will result in the chocolate having a different crystal formation, and that means that your chocolate isn't shiny, or worse. Forms 1 and 2, which is obtained by rapid cooling as opposed to really gradual cooling for form 5, don't have any snap. They just crumble and they're super messy. Forms 3 and 4 are a little bit better, but they still have no good snap. Finally, form 6, which you can't actually get from tempering, but you only get if you encounter old chocolate, like really old 4-month old chocolate, is way too firm and just no longer good. Also know that all of these forms contain some amount of chocolate blooms. Have you ever looked at old chocolate and wondered what that weird whitey stuff was? That stuff is chocolate blooms, which either comes from changes in the chocolate's fat or the chocolate sugar collecting moisture. It's safe to eat, but it just doesn't taste as good as the amazingness that is beta crystal chocolate.
That was really interesting. That really drew my curiosity. Drew curiosity. Draw curiosity. Check out Anais's channel. Huh. That was some pretty sweet science. Man, that was the best pun I ever made. You know, natural, funny, it works. Ah. You know, just take us out past me. Hmm. And that is why chocolate is shiny. Thanks for watching, DFTBA, and explore on. I'll never hide. I can't. I'm too shiny. This is the first of a series of videos I made when I went to Peru, so stick around for more in the upcoming weeks and months. Thank you to the Chocolate Museo in Cusco, thank you to this amazing person for making amazing fan art, and thank you to the Anais from Draw Curiosity for coming on the show. Check out her channel, it really is amazing. Also, thank you to all my patrons on Patreon, especially Dave, Emma Juice, Kevin, Nick, and Ryan. You know, it's patrons like those people who support me over at patreon.com/technicality that allows me to do stuff like buying those beans and nibs so I can show you the science hands-on. And if you think that added to your technicality experience, I would greatly appreciate it if you considered supporting me over there. Thank you so much, see you guys next time.
Wee baboo!